Okay, welcome to the W3C WebRTC Working Group meeting for August. Oops. This group abides by the W3C patent policy, which is listed in the link. And only people and companies listed on the status page are allowed to make substantive contributions. So today we're going to talk about a number of topics, including captured surface control, moving forward with mute, speaker selection, scale resolution down to, and some codec matching. In terms of future meetings, we're going to have TPAC from September 23rd to 27th. And then we have our regular monthly meetings on October 15th, November 19th, and December 10th. So a little bit about TPAC. Venue is the Hilton Anaheim in California. So all the times are in Pacific Daylight Time, UTC minus 7. We have, in terms of schedule, meetings on Tuesday, September 24th, 3.5 hours for the WebRTC Working Group, and 1.5 hours with the SCCG joint meeting. Then on Wednesday, there are breakout sessions. And on Thursday, we have a joint meeting with the WebRTC, with the media working group. So lots of time at TPAC, and I'd like to ask you to think about big issues or things that might be difficult to handle during a monthly meeting, and ask us for time. We'll be making up the schedule pretty soon. So if there's something ambitious that you've had in mind, we will probably will have time to do it, or even if it's not so ambitious but takes a little time. About the meeting, slides are up on the wiki. The meeting's being recorded and will be public. Do we have volunteers for note taking?
I'll do it.
Okay, thank you, Don. Reminder about the code of conduct. We operate under it and we're all passionate about improving WebRTC, but let's keep it cordial and professional. So I think you all know this by now, how to operate Google Meet, but raise your hand to get into the queue, lower it to get out of it. Wait for microphone access. Try to avoid echo by using headphones. State your name, particularly if we don't know you, if you haven't been attending. And I don't think we'll use Pulse today, probably. Okay, just about document status. Just because something's in a repo doesn't mean it's adopted. And we do try to make that clear in the drafts, particular what represents consensus and what doesn't. Okay, so here's what's on the agenda. Capture surface control and moving forward with mute. Guido will lead us in that. Then Jan Aber will talk about speaker selection. We have scale resolution down to for Henrik to talk about. And then we'll get into codec matching, which I'm sure will be a fun subject. All right, Guido, you have the floor.
Okay, so capture surface control. A couple of meetings ago, we proposed an API that allows an application to send a wheel and zoom events to a captured surface. And the use case for that is allowing a VC application to scroll and zoom the captured content. That is being shared in the meeting. So the initial comments that we got from that proposal was that the use case of the local user zooming and scrolling the capture content is appealing and worth exploring. So we should try to find a solution for this use case. At least there seems to be consensus to find such a solution. Then there are more doubts about the use case of a remote user zooming and scrolling. So that's a use case that some users want to support. So it's called co-presenting. So let's say multiple people presenting in the same call. But this one has some privacy concerns. So I think I make progress if we focus initially on the local user and keep the discussion for the remote use case without blocking the local use case. And the other feedback is that the API should not be extended to support those other types of user input, such as keystrokes or mouse presses, precisely to prevent remote control, which is something we don't want to support. And yes, and that the UA might be in a better position than the application for some of these actions. So can you please go to the next slide. So this is a summary of what the original proposal looks like. So we have a method called sendWheel for scrolling that basically allows the application to send a wheel event to the capture surface. And we have, for zooming, we have a method called setZoomLevel, which does the same for zoom, plus a few other supporting methods to know like supported zoom levels, the current zoom level, and an event to be notified about changes in the zoom level. So next, please. So first, we want to focus on the wheel. So here's an alternative proposal for wheel events. So in this case, the application doesn't send individual wheel events, but instead the application starts like capturing wheel events from a given HTML element. So for example, you start capturing the wheel events of the video element where you're playing a stream track with the presentation, and then those all wheel events on that element are forwarded automatically to the capture surface by the browser. So please go to the next slide. So the code would be something like this. So you create a capture controller, invoke the display media with that controller. You also have a video element, start playing the video element the stream in the video element. And then you tell the controller to start capturing the wheel events of the video element, and then that automatically starts forwarding wheel events to the capture surface. If it's a tab, the tab will get wheel events in their global scope. And to stop capturing, then you just tell it to capture null. So you can capture at most one element at a time per controller, and you have an easy way to stop capturing. Next, please. So yes, like I said, the capture wheel forwards events to the capture surface. This, like in the original proposal, this is all subject to permission, to a new permission called capture surface control, which prompts the user if necessary. And yeah, the difference with the sendWheel proposal is that the UA takes care of the forwarding instead of the application. So that prevents the remote control. And yes, coordinates are scaled automatically from the size of the element that's been captured to the size of the capture surface. And yeah, the delta values, or like the magnitude of the wheel events is preserved for simplicity. And yeah, the main advantage is that, well, it's very easy to use because the application, this basically does what applications were doing with sendWheel. And it only supports the local use cases. The advantage is that, of course, it's less flexible than the method for sending individual events. But for the local use case, that that's okay. Next slide, please. And then there was the issue of how do we tackle the restrict the presuming, so how do we restrict it to the local use case? So this concerns mainly the setSum level method. Next slide, please. And this case is trickier because SUMing always involves UI, and applications prefer to build their own UI so that they provide the user a consistent experience. So our proposal in this case is to make sure that all calls to setSum level require transient user activation. So this is pretty big, not a completely perfect solution, but I think this mitigates the issue well enough that it's impractical to abuse this API to implement remote control. And especially now that you cannot even do a scrolling at the application level. So, this type of restriction is easy to understand. It's very common in many other APIs for similar purposes. And the requirement for the application is reasonable, so it doesn't, it still gives them plenty of flexibility. And this is a good solution for Zoom. It's more difficult for SendWheel because wheel events don't give user activation. So the solution for scrolling is the capture wheel method that I just talked about. So next slide, please. So that's pretty much it. So what do people think about this updated proposal? Yes, Junior.
I cannot hear you. Jennifer, you look unmuted, but we cannot hear you. same problem. No.
How about now? Can you hear me now?
Perfect.
All right. Sorry about that. So thank you for presenting that. I do think the capture wheel solution, I think it looks elegant. So I think that's very promising. So I think I'm supportive of that one. I'm actually wondering why we couldn't use that for Zoom as well. And then if you have a preview tile, it would seem a nice compromise for having some browser control, browser provided controls for that. That might be better than a similar solution to capture wheel. I imagine in some OSs you can even hold a control key and control zoom level with the capture wheel. So there's a bit of overlap here, perhaps. I had a question. So I'm wondering, with the zoom level, I know there's I'm wondering if there'll be an opportunity to give feedback on the API. I think, like, for instance, like get zoom level for synchronous methods, I generally prefer attributes. I'm wondering if that could be more logical. And on the last point, on the transient activation, I think you had earlier mentioned that you would also, I mean, transient activation by itself, excuse me, is perhaps not that strict of a requirement because in many browsers that could be up to 4 seconds. Unless you consume the user activation. Are you talking about consuming the user activation in this case for this API?
Yes, I would say so.
Okay. And so that would be a button then that the user pushes. I'm trying to picture how this would work in practice. It would be a plus and minus buttons.
It could also be the on the keyboard, right? It all depends on the app.
Right.
It could also be the P and the M buttons, you know, on the keyboard, right, depending on what the user does.
Okay. And the last question is, I was curious why the zoom levels are integers between 0 and 100 and not like a double or something like that.
That's simply because it's easier to deal with integers than to deal with floating point numbers. But it's something we can, it's not a...
When we designed it like that, we designed it to match what most user agents currently show the user. So if I look at Chrome at the moment, but I suspect that Firefox does the same, there is a 100% that's shown to the user and it goes down, it goes up, but it's always an integer. And users seem to understand that. And you can imagine that instead of a plus and minus, you could also have a drop-down list where the user basically sees all of the supported values and chooses one of those, which, by the way, is one of my answers to your question of why not do the capture wheel for Zoom. The reason is that it wouldn't necessarily be a single button. It could also be a drop-down list. It could be a radio button. It could be one of many things.
It can be slider. There are many different UI options. And this is not as easy to come up with a straightforward way to associate many different types of user interface or even keyword things to this functionality. But given that the potential and the problem that we want to solve is not allow remote control, there's very little that you can do with a Zoom API if it's protected by transient activation.
Yes, I think my main proposal would be if we could do the element solution also for Zoom. That would be my preference. Does the Zoom affect just the capture or the original document as well?
The original document as well.
Okay. All right, thanks. I see you went on the queue.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So I discussed a little bit the topic internally, and especially the case of being able to control zooming and scrolling of a different app, meaning you capture a window and somehow the user agent is now able to send commands to that window. And it has been brought to me that it's a very highly privileged, it's a very high bar to actually get to that. Because in terms of security, we know that browsers are an attack surface, and being able to send commands to other apps is not a possibility currently in browsers. And if we implement that for Window, then we would need to allow some of these things. So I got some pushback from that respect. And then if it's not available in the future on Window, then have it in tabs. Why should we have it in tabs? That's another question. So basically, on the feature, there is some pushback really with regards to security issues and user agents being attacked. And the less we provide user agents high privilege like that, the better it is. That's my first point. And over my other points, I agree that they should consume activation. And the other question was related to scrolling. What about touch? What about iPads? You can scroll with your fingers and so on. So it should also be people. So maybe capture wheel, you know, is not the best name and the best API shape, because you should handle iPads as well.
Something that I had was that capture scrolling might be a better name. So we can iterate on the name. Yeah, that's not an issue. And we can start with tabs initially, say that only tabs are supported for now, and then in the future,
I think the spec even says that right now.
Yeah. Right now, it's sure, certainly but, the implementation that we're experimenting with only supports tabs, and yeah, we can make it clear that the only support the surface is a browser, and we can have the window in the future. A potential future work where we can try to discuss the potential security issues for that.
There could be different mitigations for tab and for window. They don't have to be the same, and we could even have a completely separate API for the window in the future if we discover that for some reason it needs to be different.
Well, maybe. But one point is that in terms of UX, there's either you embed everything in the capturing app, or you actually try to push the user to manipulate the application that is being captured, and somehow the capturing app is on the side, and you can get to it very easily. And maybe there's some work that could be done in terms of UX for the second part, and then the scrolling and so on would be of less interest.
It's true that there are alternatives, but there's trade-offs. So, for example, one alternative approach is to use a PIP, right? Picture-in-picture. And it works for some users in some conditions, and it doesn't work for the same users in other conditions. So, for example, you lose access to the chat, emoji reactions in the case of Meet, and other features that we are going to build into Meet in the future that we don't even know about right now, right? Any kind of theoretical thing, because you're not going to be able to cram all of that into the PIP. And any other web application will run into the same limitation that there is finite real estate on the screen to make use of. You could also go the other way around, right? Where you've got a PIP of the captured surface, and maybe you kind of scroll over that, and maybe you've got zoom buttons over that. But again, you run into other issues where basically, now you've got duplication, right? The Meet application shows you one preview, you've got another preview. So it's true that there are other approaches, but they seem to me inferior in terms of user experience.
I certainly don't have the full solution here. it's still an area of exploration. For instance, on macOS, you can now put yourself as a presenter within the captured feed as well. So there's a lot of experiments, and I don't want to block that, but still the fact that as a user, if I select a tab and suddenly I can scroll, and if I select a window I cannot scroll, it's a bad user experience, because the user might not understand the difference, why is it working in one case and not the other. So that's why it would be interesting if long term we know that, for instance, Chrome is really interested in adding that kind of support for window as well, or whether it will remain in tab. Because if you want to push it for window, then there are additional requirements that the OS will need to meet for Chrome to implement this feature for window. And that's important to know whether that's actually feasible or not. And I don't know whether it's feasible or not, or whether it will be feasible or not in the future.
So what do you think about supporting tabs initially?
Yuen, I think Guido asked you.
Sure, tab is interesting, but then if we're capturing tab, we can have a different API. We can have different things. So I'd like to understand whether longer term window is really something that you want to dedicate efforts to or not. And I see you're on the queue, so maybe.
I just want to answer that. I think that without actually shipping this for tabs, we are not actually going to know to what degree users even like this. And until we validate that tabs are meaningful, it would not make sense to invest in Windows, especially given that you, as you yourself mentioned, It's more complicated security-wise, and it requires per-platform code, right? Because it's not, you're not going to control Mac and Windows the same way. So I think that if we ship this, we can validate the entire approach. And if we find that users don't like that and they go for alternatives, then we can proceed a different way.
Danny, were you about to say something?
So I just wanted to add that regarding the user activation, transient user activation, that doesn't actually solve the remote use case. It doesn't solve the remote use attack, if you will. It still allows an application to understand the level. Like if I set Zoom level to 100, that's going to confuse the user a lot. So initially, an approach that is more similar to the wheel would be better because it would ensure much. I would have much more confidence that the control couldn't leave the local machine.
Yeah, it would be better from one point of view, but it would be worse.
Sorry,
another point of view.
I disagree. I think it would not solve it at all because there is no guarantee that the button that you connected to this thing actually says plus or zoom in or anything that the user understands. For all you know, the button that you've connected this action to says cancel, exit, stop. So I don't think that we can actually do better than use transient activation here.
No, I think we can because the media elements already have control buttons. And I know a lot of websites prefer to put in their own customizations and styling of those. But I think that's a separate issue in that, you know, we could, for instance, Firefox has a picture-in-picture button in the media element. So I think I'd like to explore solutions where you could perhaps turn this on and you would see browser-provided buttons to do zooming, for example.
Yeah, but
which might differ, like on iPad, for instance, you might have different needs where you could pinch zoom. So it seems like this is well within the domain of browser UX to improve upon.
But one question, when you say this doesn't solve the problem, what do you mean doesn't solve the problem? That means that it's possible for a malicious application to send a zoom event, which, yes, of course, that's possible, yes, provided that the user clicked on a button, which might also be possible.
Or click anywhere on the page.
Folks, we're over time on this item right now. So can we wrap it up quickly?
So if I understand correctly, at least for Send Wheel, Yennefer, you seem to like the new approach.
I do.
Yuen, do I understand correctly that you're for this, at least for tabs, or am I taking too many liberties here?
Yeah, I think our current feedback is pretty negative. But I think that if we have to go, if we are going there, and our feedback would be that keeping most of the control in the hand of a user agent would be better. And it's true that media controls on this hand is a nice approach we could try to investigate.
So pretty negative for Windows as well as tabs, or because you've mentioned the problems with Windows, but I didn't really understand if you're opposed to tabs, like assuming that we only do tabs.
I'm not opposed to tabs, at least currently. The more we can, the user agent can control it, the better it will be. And that will apply to Windows as well, I'm pretty sure. If we want to extend it, having high guarantees that we can control it is good.
Thank you.
Okay, we're going to move on to the next item. Sorry.
So, talk more about Mute. We have been talking about Mute a lot in several meetings in the recent months, and we have made progress in some areas. Like we have agreed that synchronizing the Mute state, including the UI across applications, user agent, OS, is a good fit for the media session API. And this also includes unmute requests from the application. But there are still other areas in Mute that needs improvement, and those improvements I think will lead to better interoperability between implementations. So let's go to the next slide. So one of the issues is that the spec includes, since many years ago, it includes language that is roughly equivalent of two things. One, that a track being muted implies no frame. So basically, like this model is the user mutes something, and then either no frames are produced or only black frames are produced. So that's a good fit for the user manually muting a track with hardware switches, with or with controls in the user agent or the operating system. So Chromium uses this definition for audio. And if I understand correctly, Safari and Firefox use this definition for both video and audio. But the spec also has another language that is like the opposite, that if a source is not producing any frames, it actually says only no frames or no content. But I guess that also applies to black frames, like source information content. That implies that the track is muted. And that fits use cases where when the track temporarily stops sending frames for no known reason, but there is no underlying failure. So the track could resume at any point sending frames again. And it indirectly works for some of the manual mutes, because if the manual mute also results in no frames being sent, then this also results in a muted track using this definition. So Chrome uses this definition for video. But then, can you go to the next slide? But ideally, it would be great if we would have at this point only the first part of the definition and handle the second part differently. But the fact is that this language has been stuck for a long time, and there's an implementation that has followed it for just as long. And more importantly, so we have contacted developers, and quite a few of them have expressed that they find this signal useful and they actually use it, even if it's not related to a user mute. So my proposal is leave the spec language as is for now and add an additional Boolean attribute that we might call is sending frame or something like that to media stream track video stats, such that we can use that attribute for the second version of the or for the second part of the definition, and then that can make it a lot easier to start implementing the first version of the definition, because we're giving developers a direct path to continue using the old functionality. We could even say that functionality is temporary, since you can also implement that at the application level. So please go to the next slide. This provides a signal that they currently are getting with the old definition, so makes it easy to for Chrome to start using the first part of the definition without creating a lot of compatibility problems. So at least it's giving an easy upgrade path. And yes, and maybe we can even remove it in the future, because a similar signal can be inferred with video stats using the frame counter and using timeouts. Having a Boolean will have similar properties as the old muted attribute, and it's more ergonomic. So it's especially for applications that are currently using the existing signal. So please go to the next slide. And then the other thing I want to propose is about black frames. So for video tracks, information contact can mean black frames or no frames. And applications currently can and do detect black frames just by analyzing every frame. But on some platforms, there are system APIs that make it possible to detect that the camera is in a mode where it's producing only black frames at the system level. It's just specific reasons like a laptop lit down or an OS setting or there could be several reasons. And then applications will benefit from using this more efficient way of detection of black frames. And so the proposal would be to add two or maybe just one field to video stats. So one called the system black frames, so a counter for these system level black frames, and also a Boolean saying that if the last frame was system black, so to make it easier for applications to detect the condition without using timeouts. And then the other things, we would mark the track muted when this condition is detected, which probably doesn't need any spec change, since this is typically due to an user action and results in some information content. So this is basically the definition of muting. So next slide. So the advantage is applications can detect black frames more efficiently instead of having to inspect every frame. And the mute signal together with the stat can help the application provide more accurate information to the user, because the mute signal can help the mute event can help the application detect, okay, the user did something that is resulting in black frames. So next slide. So the proposed IDL is basically adding those three fields to media screen, tracks, video, stats, with the definition that I just mentioned. I think that's all. Let's go next. I don't think that there's anything else. So what do you think? Yes, Yuan.
So the first thing is track muted, at least in WebKit, means no frame. It doesn't mean black frames. And I think it would be good to first decide what we do with black frames. Because, for instance, it's JavaScript observable. Somehow we request video frame callback or with a media stream track processor. If a track is muted, at least in Safari, there will be no callback. There will be no read chunk because there's no frame. So I'm wondering whether we can tighten the case of either the black frame. Maybe you can drop it if the user agent can detect it. Then maybe it should just drop it and maybe use mute and do something like that, so that we have like a consistent mute equals no frame, and not mute equals either no frame or black frame.
I'm not opposed to doing that. I'm actually okay with that, but we probably need to change the spec, because the spec in different places mentions black frames as the definition of muted for video.
Okay. We can try to dig into that. Maybe other folks will agree, or we can all agree on muted equal no frame. About is sending frames, I'm not sure to exactly understand how we would specify it, because somehow it's really like it's similar to if the total number of frames is increasing. But then
it doesn't specify as it's currently specified, that if a source is not producing frames, then the track is muted. Well, if a source is not producing frames, then it's sending frame if false. Well, I mean, it's already written. It's just that it refers to the mute attribute instead of this new attribute. So basically what I want, like long-term, ideally what we would do is initially send move applications that are using muted with that definition to this new attribute. And then eventually, if possible, ask them to use the frame counter and then get rid of the attribute. And then we can move to only the first part of the definition.
In that case, I'm not sure Safari would implement that, and it would be better. It would be better that the absence of this field means that everything is fine. It's producing, you know, so that whether we implement it or not, there's no compat issue. So maybe we can think of something like that.
Maybe it could be specified as at risk, and then you just add it and immediately mark it as at risk.
Is sending frame equal false? I would prefer is not sending frames, and so that if it's not there, then it means it's sending frames. So it seems more compatible for implementations that will not implement it.
I don't know who's next. We're not. Is it new or?
And last thought. If we go down with black frames, then if the source is generating black frames and we are dropping them, I'm fine with adding a counter for that kind of things. It seems okay in that case, because somehow we are describing what the source is doing.
Yeah, I share some of UN's concerns here, because I think originally we did say that you would be sending black frames when you were muted. But I think we haven't thought through all of the implications of that for the entire system. As UN said in something like media capture transform, it makes a difference as to whether you're emitting video frames or not, you know, whether you're sending them. And then to try to go back and infer that you're muted from seeing black frames, I think I'm concerned about all the interoperability problems that could be that could result from different browser interpretations of this and all the different APIs that would be affected by the difference between sending and not sending. Guido, do you remember the reason why we decided to send black frames as opposed to not sending? Was there
that was there already when I started to work in this area. So
yeah.
Been there forever from my point of view.
We did the discussion and I think it was Seattle, where we decided that when you mute the track, you want the picture to turn black. But when you pause the transceiver, you want the picture to be frozen.
Right.
We wanted to support both outcomes, and we kind of randomly decided that muting a track would turn it black. Sending a single black frame at the moment you mute is perfectly consistent with the definition. Continuing to send black frames is also consistent with the definition.
On remote side, the peer connection is sending black frames for any muted track. But on the local preview, whether you send a black frame or whether it's the user agent that will render black, is in our control, so we can do something like that. So I think it's different from if we take the source and if we take peer connection, and we can take different actions there.
Yeah.
Geneva, are you also in the queue?
Yes, so thank you. And I appreciate you wanting to move toward us back here, and this is a potential migration path. I also agree that is not sending frames would be better, because that would be more simpler to mute, because it's a negation. But also sending, I think, is the wrong word. We're not sending anything here, so it may be producing. It's not producing frames.
Name is subject to discussion, and whether a negative definition or a positive definition. I'm more concerned about the approach of having this functionality also as a not great path to simplify the spec with regards to mute, which is
Yeah. So I'm sympathetic to solving this, and I think adding a stat might be a good approach, but I'm a bit concerned that we're adding three stats here, and it seems a bit excessive. I'm wondering, for instance, just maybe counting black frames. We're already counting delivered frames already, so some kind of counter that says which of these are black might be useful independent of solving this particular thing. So that might have more traction, perhaps. Also, I think I could be wrong, but I think even Safari produces a black frame on mute. I thought all browsers did that.
Only on peer connection. If you pipe a track to a peer connection, then the sender will send a black frame every second or so. But other than that, in media recorder, maybe, but it's really not the track. It's really the consumer of the track that is getting the muted signal, and then is doing some specific processing based on the signal, not based on the fact that there's a track that is being sent to each consumer.
Okay, I'm pasting a fiddle in the comment here. I seem to be getting black even in a local case on track mute. So, but in any case, I support wanting to get closer to the spec here, and if we can negate it, like you and I like Ewan's proposal of if
the not that we're not getting closer to the spec. Sorry to interrupt you, but we're not getting closer to the spec. What we want is to move to a situation where we can simplify the spec. Because Chrome's implementation is completely spec compliant because the spec contains both
definitions. Yes.
What we want is long term get rid of the second definition.
Yes, sorry, I misspoke. The spec right now says that it's implementation defined, the mute behavior is implementation defined. Yes. I get questioned the history of the intent seemed to me to be always that mute was a user control. And I'm glad if there's support for that view. And and I agree that we need to solve a bit of a problem here so that hopefully Chromium can align with the other browsers on when it sets mute and when it doesn't. And is that still a goal?
Yeah, that's a goal.
For Chromium to do
that? Improve interoperability so that mute becomes useful for more useful for applications with more browsers.
Yeah.
Use a more restricted definition that works.
That's what I meant, yes. So I'm sensitive to that approach. But I think adding three stats instead of one seems a bit much.
Well, it's two problems we're solving here. So
yeah.
It's two different things, but they're all related to mute.
Okay.
Tim, we're out of, we reached the time, but I don't know, maybe you can.
Yeah, very, very, very super brief. Just want to say that if you're using stats, everyone's polling them anyway. So I don't think the issue about whether you have to re-come back and look every 2 seconds matters, because everyone's doing that anyway.
Right. So maybe we can, I don't disagree with you, but part at least for the is producing frame or is not producing frame, whatever we want to call it, the idea is to have a smooth upgrade path for people who are using the old definition. So and then we can say that will be deprecated and removed, and that the recommendation is to use the counter and an application level timeout. Hendrik?
I suspect that as a migration path, now that we have the two different implementations of mute, that you actually do need this Boolean. Because if I recall correctly, if muted Chrome implementation, then the counters would stop incrementing. So that you can only migrate to looking at the counter if mute has been corrected.
Okay, I think we're gonna need to move to the next item.
Okay. Sorry, just for the minutes, discussion will continue on the relevant issue in media capture.
I think I can start prepare some PRs and make sure that I think that I have issues filed for this, but I'll go through them again and then continue the discussion there with some concrete PRs that we can iterate.
Should I file an issue about no, like muted video track means no frame, and we can
that would be an issue.
Okay, I'll file an issue.
Actually, please do, UN. I think this actually might be a topic for TPAC in the joint media working group because of all of the effects that has throughout the whole system. Okay, Yanivar, you have the floor.
All right, thank you. So I'm going to be talking about two issues in media capture output. The first one should hopefully be simple, removing a case of prompting in an edge case. And the second one about figuring out the default or the system default audio output device. Next slide. So the current spec has a step five in select audio output. That basically, with select audio output, you can pass in a device ID. Excuse me. which is a way to, well, the background here is that select audio output brings up a prompt, but there are cases where you might want to use, and it returns a media devices info object where you can get a device ID and you can store that in local storage, for example, for next time. But you can't use it directly immediately with setSync ID. You have to call select audio output, passing in the device ID to vet it. And if the user agent likes that ID, it can then skip the prompt and you get it right back and you can call setSync ID on it. but the spec basically was not thinking about microphone. So the one way to, was only thinking about the one way of getting device IDs, which was through previous calls to select audio output, but it neglected to specify that it could also be from get user media. And apologies, I've forgotten to update my slide here. It should say get user media. That was one of the feedback instead of enumerate devices here. So it's basically about updating the spec to recognize that device IDs, exposed device IDs can come through both select audio output and get user media through the microphone permission exemption. So that if you have a speaker that has the same group ID as a microphone that has microphone permission, in that case, you might get an ID that way. And that to me makes sense because how a persistent speaker ID was exposed in the past shouldn't matter. Any objection to this? UN?
Yeah, this is fine to me. The small caveat is that if we say enumerate devices, then it means that all output speakers that have been exposed in enumerate devices would be in scope. However, if it's get user media, it's only the output speaker that would be exposed as part of a microphone capture that would be exposed. Because currently with enumerate devices, you will expose all microphones in enumerate devices. But get user media is only exposing the microphone that is being captured. So I was wondering, like the current PR is fuzzy about that. I'm guessing that since we talked about this and you switched to get user media, you're meaning restricted scope, but maybe you meant the extended scope. So that's the thing we need to precise in the PR, I guess.
Yeah, so I have updated the PR here in the link to say get user media instead of enumerate devices. Is that sufficient or did you want additional language?
I was wondering whether a note would help stating that if it means that it's a speaker that was tied to a microphone that was used, what was actually used in the past, and it's only that. It's not like other devices that have been exposed as part of enumerate devices. It's not really clear from there, because from this PR.
Okay. No, I'm happy to work with you on refining that language. That's great to me. Thank you for the feedback. If there are no other objections, then I think we can move to the next slide. All right, so this is a problem in that the first audio output device in the numeric devices is not always the default device. Even though the enumerate devices has this rule for camera, microphone, and speakers, but the first device is always a system default device. And that works great when all the devices are exposed, which is the case for camera and microphone. But for audio output devices, speakers, this is not the case, because the select audio output API uses a browser picker to expose individual speakers. And that is consistent with the PEG and the ping design guides for enumeration of devices. So you're not supposed to enumerate. It's always preferable to have a model that doesn't expose information about devices you're not using. Now, we do have, I call it the microphone loophole in the spec, which is that any speaker that has the same group ID as a microphone will also be enabled, will also be exposed with microphone permission. And we have to maintain that for backwards compatibility. But that doesn't mean, that still means that you can't expose non-mic related speakers. So there are still cases where I might have exposed my AirPods, for example, and picked those in the browser picker. But right now it'll be listed first, but that doesn't mean it's necessarily the system default. So, and websites, to get in with the slide here, websites today would like to take advantage of this enumerate devices guarantee, that the way to find the default speaker is it's the first one enumerated of that kind. And this makes it hard to write interoperable apps. And we see that already in some websites, that there's often not a way to, in Firefox, for instance, there's no way to reset. The website is not offering the user a way to reset to the default, which is an empty string. Next slide. So there's been some debate on the issue here. And they're basically surrounding around two proposals, as far as I can tell, is that if at least one other audio output device is exposed, but the one that is currently the system default is not, then we prepend an entry for it, for the system default, that looks like this. And this is A or B, but what they have in common is that these are limited entries, similar to what we do in enumerate devices ahead of GUM exposure. And the idea here is to put in a placeholder, and it can have a browser-defined label, but it has the kind of audio output, and it has an empty string as device ID, which is proposal A, or it has the string default, which is proposal B. Now, I'm partial to proposal A here, because this already works with set sync ID empty string, which means there's no change needed to call that out as a special case, which means that any website unaware of this would try to call setSync ID with this would basically set back to the default device, which seems correct because it's the first one listed. One advantage of not using empty string, perhaps, is that right now, if you pass an empty string to select audio output, it would always prompt. So having a string that wasn't an empty string might be an advantage there. Now, I also think it's fairly rare, perhaps, to persist an empty string. And this is easily avoided by checking, like, if local storage dot speaker ID, then call select audio output. But both of these approaches solve the the basic use case here of a web application needing to know which speaker is the default, well, it's OS level default, system default, user agent default. These are all the same different words for the same thing, null implementations. So that's the proposal. And the label here is up to user agent, which might be an empty string, or it might be something like system default speakers. And that's my last slide. So discuss. Let's see, UN.
So if we already have an audio output entry, it means that somehow we're already out of passive fingerprinting. So why not exposing the real device ID for the default? And maybe the label, I'm not even sure that the label, we want to sanitize it. Maybe we want to sanitize it or reduce it, but there might be no harm in passing the, that was my question. I guess that if the default changes, then now it's a bit different. So my question is, in any case, can we just put a device ID, like the actual value for the default device, and be done with it?
If we did that, that would change the rule, and that device ID would now be valid input to setthink ID. So if the case is that I'm in select audio output, I pick my AirPods, but these happen to not be the OS system default, then passing in a real device ID here would, there's a difference in semantics here, because these are all physical representations of physical devices, one of which happens to be the user default, which is very different from the, I call it the large D default, that Chrome has a virtual default device. So here in the spec doesn't talk about such a device. So in the spec, if we assume that these are all physical devices, then setSync ID empty string is very different semantically from setSync ID with the device ID that happens to be the OS default right now. So the goal here was to surgically solve just this one problem of calling enumerated devices and getting the first device of audio output device and assuming that was the system default. That's sort of all we're trying to do here.
I understand that if you set sync ID to the empty string, then you want to follow the default. And if the default is changing, then you want the default, like the audio, to be routed to the new default. And if you set the real device ID, then it's different. I'm fine with both proposal A and B. I think that we can update the spec if needed. I kind of prefer a non-empty string. I think it's a bit clearer. But to be extra sure, whenever the default is actually exposed, we would no longer see this specific entry, right?
Correct, yes.
Okay.
So in the case of if I pick my AirPods and they happen to be the OS default, that will be the only device that is exposed, and that is all I see. So the problem with adding a physical device ID to the instead of empty string or instead of default would be that would effectively expose two audio output sources for use when I just pick one. Okay. I see Guido on the queue. Guido, are you muted?
Yes. So my comment here is that you said that UA default and system default, they're the same thing. My argument is that they're not the same thing. And system default, the way I interpret system default is that you map it to what the underlying platform calls system default. So normally that would be a device where you track the system default. So if the system default changes the operating system, that means that the output follows that. That's very important because it's not the same thing, and you don't use the same underlying, you don't use the default device concept of the operating system. If you just pass the specific ID of the device that is currently pointed out by the system default. And that has implications even for privacy, because so let's say if you call setSync ID with a specific device ID, and then say you remove that device ID, then you should get silence. But if you are playing with the system default device, then the audio should follow the new default device when you remove the device ID, and the operating system automatically changes the default device. So it's they're not the same thing, because the UA could have its own default, and that default may not necessarily be that following the system default. So I disagree that UA default and system default are the same thing. Maybe that was the intent when the spec was written, especially because the early versions were written early, and there was not such distinction, and the system default was thought of to be the UA default, which is particularly the case in Chromium. So I think we need to be more specific about what a system default device means, because I think a system default device would be similar, or would be exactly what the device with the default ID is exposing in Chrome. The one we call virtual, although it's really no more virtual than the physical ones. But it's a good distinction here. So I think we need to iterate on several of these concepts, because they're not the same thing. System default and a specific device that is currently the default don't have the same behavior, and are really not the same thing. So we probably need to iterate on that. In regards of using the labels, I will be partial to using the default string, because it's the empty string is overloaded to mean many different things in many different parts of different specs. So I think it's more confusing. The default string would be better, but I would support it only if it's a device like Chrome's default device, that it's a device that's truly a system default, not one that is currently pointed out by the as default.
Okay, I'm a bit confused, because I think the spec mostly talks about system audio, the system default, and it doesn't talk about UA default. And
no.
Even in Chrome, I don't think any browser has a separate default from the OS, does it?
Well, I would argue that Firefox doesn't have a system default device, only a UA default that is the one currently pointed out at as default, but it's not really a default device. So if you do setSync ID with the device that you're calling default, you're not going to get the same behavior as setSync ID with the empty string.
Yeah. On macOS, there's a similar concept where you can say the audio will go to the default speaker. Whether it changes or not, it will go to the next default speaker, and so on.
Sure.
And there's a different where you send the audio to the current device, to the current default device. And if this device goes away, then audio is going out. And so I agree there's a difference there. And
But yes, I agree that the difference, setSync ID with empty string means follow whatever the system default is. Yes, Firefox supports that as well, I believe.
What I'm saying is that the first device that you're saying is default is a default, or it's a UA default, not a system default, at least in Firefox.
So because
it doesn't behave like a system default device, and it's not mapped to the system default concept of the underlying platform.
No, but so the spec, the Firefox and the spec does not have a virtual device.
No,
The Chrome adds an additional virtual device that's called the default, right?
So I would argue that that's the only way to implement a system default. But a UA default could not necessarily be that.
That's redundant.
Depending on the timing.
we're over time here, so we should probably take the last person in the queue, which I think is Harold, and then move on. Harold?
So just reminding that default is a tricky concept. One of the reasons why the language is so wishy-washy is that Windows, at the time we defined this 10 years ago, had two. One for telephony and one for other audio. So referring to the UA default might be better, because I think none of those things actually, none of the browsers actually reflected that particular complexity. So system default is not a defined term. So that's all.
Okay, thank you for the feedback. I would like to point out that empty string is already called out in the spec to be a dynamic default.
Right? Yep. So, we already made that mistake once. Empty string is usually a mistake.
But, well, not necessarily, because that's a default behavior that is backwards compatible to people who are not using this API. Right? So this is an override API, basically. You can set an override and you can clear the override. That seems semantically simple. Except if we introduce new labels and new device IDs. All right, thank you. We'll continue on the issue.
All right, time for scalar resolution down two. This is a new API proposal in the encoding parameters that was discussed in the May 2023 virtual interim. So just to recap, this API is just like scalar resolution down by, except that you specify the absolute resolution. So if you want to set 360p, you say 360p instead of the relative. Type on the slide instead of relative terms. So today you would say scale down by 2 if you have a 720p input frame. So that's the main difference between the API. And the motivation for this is that if you're doing simulcast and you're doing effects processing that can be quite expensive. If you disable the top layer, there's no reason to do 720p effects processing. So you want to do a 360p effects processing in this case, which means you have to change the resolution of the track on the fly. And the problem with the current API is that when you change the resolution like this, you must adjust the scaling factors, and this is inherently racy. The way to avoid it is to disable the encodings, wait a while, and then re-enable them. And that would be perceived as glitchy. So I talked about this over a year ago. There was overall support, but there were several things that I have not thought about or specified, mainly what happens if the orientation changes from landscape to portrait mode. And how to handle aspect ratios and stuff like that. So, and lastly, I think Yuan said he's supportive as long as it doesn't get too complicated. But I promised to follow up on this, and that was a year ago. So here I am with some follow-up. Next slide. So last time we talked about this, then I said you should just specify the height, but that doesn't work if the orientation changes. So with the new proposal, well, it also has an issue if you have very weird resolutions. But so in the new proposal, I think you should specify width and height, which is also what we do in the C++ layer. And the way to keep this simple is to we never upscale, we only downscale, same as with the scale down by, and we never change the aspect ratio. So if you want to scale it, you make sure that it's within the width and height bounds. And the way to make this orientation agnostic is that you make sure that if the frame changes orientation internally, we will adjust so the landscape or portrait mode matches. So the app does not have to call this API again and swap width and height. It will be handled internally. This ensures that you always have the same pixel density. So the API already exists in the C++ layer. It's called requested resolution with the width and height. And I started experimenting with that. And there's some bugs that needs to be fixed, but it's generally seems to be working. So in terms of the web IDL, I tried to see if there's any existing resolution dictionary. I couldn't find one, but I saw that web codecs uses DOMRECT. We could reuse that, except DOMRECT also has an X and Y coordinate, and we don't want to reinvent yet another crop and scale. But either way, as long as it's a width and height. So my proposal is to make a PR about this. Who wants to talk? Janivar?
Yes, so I think this sounds good. On the web IDL part, yeah, I wouldn't link to anything else. Dictionaries are cheap. And I think this, I would say normally rectangle is four coordinates. So I think this is just a size or dimensions.
Just the bike shed there. It's resolution or RTC resolution.
Right. So I would scope it down to this particular case. And I guess by only downscaling. So if you set a size and then the source goes, if the source goes below that size, then it would shrink, correct?
Yes. So you send what if it's if it would result in upscale, you don't upscale. You send it as
right. Yeah. And I think the flipping for aspect ratio, excuse me, on mobile orientation. What you said about orientation, that seems to match what we do for constraints already. So I like that. So I don't. My only hesitation is whether this is actually needed. If there is some way that UA could optimize this, if the APIs are basically synchronized in JavaScript and you could detect this without needing a new API, that would be preferable. But it sounds like you've tried that.
Yeah, I don't think it's possible because the JavaScript application needs to send a signal, and media is flowing on the Medium WebRTC threads. So it's inherently racy. And even if you try to do it at the same time, you could have frames in flight. I think our buffer pool is like 10 buffers. There's no way to know.
Right. But as far as getting the information atomically from the main thread, I guess that's also complicated because you have apply constraints is asynchronous, and then there's set parameters. So, yeah, I mean, if barring any revelation that this is in fact redundant, I think this could work.
All right, Harald, I think you never removed the raising the hand, or do you want to say something?
It works automatically most of the time. So, but when you're using companion mode, it doesn't. So, sorry about that.
All right. Well, can I move forward with the PR that says to do this, except change the dictionary name, UN?
Just to be sure, this is maxed width and maxed 8. Really, it's not width and 8.
Yes,
it's max.
We can right? We can call it that, yes.
Okay.
So just to clarify, what happens if the aspect, sorry, what happens if the width divided by height difference from the source? How is this going to be handled?
Okay, if the aspect ratio is different, or?
If I put in width and height parameters that aren't the same as the ratio isn't the same as the source. So, you know, like a 16:9, I put in 16:9 dimensions for a 4x3 source. What happens? Does it crop?
It will make sure that the resulting image fits within the width and height that you specified. So whatever the most scaling is that's the thing that's being applied. So it never goes beyond the. Yeah, so max width and max height actually explains that. That's what we should call it.
Thank you.
Farhan?
What would happen if you don't specify either the width or the max height? Would you only reduce it to the dimension that you specify? Because it could be a
I hadn't thought about that. I think to keep this simple, we should probably force you to specify both of them. But it would probably be, yeah, type error makes sense to me. If there is interest, we could think about it. But for now, I don't think we need it.
I mean, that would fix issues regarding the aspect ratios, because if you just want to limit it to a specific width and you don't really care too much about the height or the other way around, then you would have a more flexible API.
Yeah, but I think if you only specify one of them, you would break this being orientation agnostic, because then you don't know if you should compare the width or the height.
Wouldn't the dictionary let you know?
Like so to avoid race conditions, I want this to work. Like nothing should happen. If I change orientation, I don't want to have to call this API again.
I mean, I guess it depends on the use case. If you really want to constrain it to width and height, then you can set both. But if you just care about maximum width, then the height could possibly change, or maximum height. Because, for example, a lot of presentations you would set a maximum height, but some people have a regular 16:9, some people have an ultra wide, some people have wider screens, and you don't necessarily want to squish that. So you would still keep the aspect ratio, but just limit the height, which could have some nice properties here. That's why I'm saying maybe we could consider allowing either parameters to be zero, in which case you ignore it or something like that.
One more consideration. So if you're capturing, for example, a window or a tab, it could be resized. So you might need to call this multiple times. And I think maybe for the application, the safest thing to do is to call it whenever it detects a change, because it's probably better to call it once too many times than to neglect to call it, right?
So if you downscale the input image, then since we don't upscale, it would be reduced in resolution. The point with the API is mainly that we avoid reconfiguring when possible. It might not be possible all the time if you just change the aspect ratio.
But this would be maybe avoiding reconfiguration in case of adaptation and not necessarily resolution change or resizing of the source.
Yes. Or say again.
It would be targeted at mainly adaptation. Once you know the resolution of your source, then you can set the right width and height that you want. And then later, it's going to only adapt in the same aspect ratio because it's just adaptation. But if someone would like to use this with a window during a presentation and people resize it, it might not be the best fit. And they will probably need to recall it anyway. So in this case, it's not a problem.
Yeah, there are pros and cons with the old API and the new APIs. The pros with the old API is that if you dynamically change things, WebRTC is very good at guessing what you want to send because it's always relative with pros and cons. And with this, you're telling WebRTC explicitly, this is what I want. If you change your mind, like that's the downside, because it's no longer guessing what you want. If you change what you actually want to send, then you would have to call this API again. And I think if you're resizing windows, you would either use scale by or you would call this API again. But this is mainly about making effects processing more efficient when you're dropping layers. Chanimar?
What happens if you pass both scale resolution 2 and scroll resolution done by?
We throw an exception. Keep it simple.
Or get something really small.
Maybe the last one should just take precedence, like seems a bit more. It seems like these are two ways of getting the same thing.
Yeah,
so whichever one you call
last. You either use one or the other. I don't think we should use one on one encoding and the other on the other encoding, or send in a dictionary with both values. It's probably indeterminate which one you'd read first. It's just, that's not super right. Keep it simple.
I understand. You could, both could be specified at the same time. Okay.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Yes.
I think we have, no, we don't have a default value for scale resolution on byte, so we can detect if it's undefined and then we can do whatever we want.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah. There's a difference between undefined and the default values. Anyway, so can I move forward with the PR? And if you have another question, I have more than a few seconds to think about it. It seems like there's no pushback on the overall design. Once, twice. Okay, next slide. I'm done. Thank you.
All right, it's me. So this is about RTC. So step parameters with the codec singular parameter, which is now in WebRTC PC, the main spec. Yay. So Firefox is trying to implement this, and we had some questions. And so this issue is filed, and the TLDR is we're trying to align with the Chromium implementation here. As expressed with web platform tests, at least. So the codec parameter, all it says basically is that it's an optional value selecting which codec is used for this encoding's RTP stream. And it's absent, the user agent can choose any negotiated codec, which kind of implies that you have to pick between negotiated codecs, but it doesn't actually say anywhere. There's no defined RTP stream selecting codec algorithm. Now there's a confusingly named codec dictionary match algorithm, which is used elsewhere to distinguish, to allow codecs to be different. And that applies to when you get capabilities, for example. If you get more than one, those have to be different. So that's not the same thing as an RTP stream selecting codec algorithm. So we should probably add that. And then we need to figure out how it should work. And so we looked at web platform tests, and they seem to be expecting that setting codec based on a static get capabilities methods, because there are several, as opposed to get parameters. So if you set codecs based on a get capability ahead of negotiation and then negotiate, the web platform test seems to expect that that codec will be used if it matches the remote SDP. But there's no explicit pros around this in the spec right now, but it definitely seems to be the intent. And the web platform test also expects codec to be automatically unset if the remote SDP does not contain a match. And there's nothing in the spec about this. So the question is, do we allow the user agent to, so next slide. Florent, you wanna comment now or at the end?
Yes, we have a provision in the spec about unsetting the codec that has been set when negotiating if the codec is not found. In the GitHub issue, I pointed out the steps, the steps numbers without doing it. And since applying an SDP is three pages long, it's very hard to notice.
Mm-hmm.
That's probably the pages is understanding it. So yeah, it's towards the end. And you can check the pull request for it or check the information.
And what determination does it use? What algorithm does it use to determine a match?
It makes a reference to the match algorithm that we have.
Ah.
as you suggested to do in the past. And so if we want to make sure that we do things better, we can improve the match algorithm, probably. Mm-hmm. And yeah. And in this case, well, it's only referencing, just to be clear, the negotiated codecs, so send codecs. Mm-hmm. But maybe since then, we had a lot of discussions about payload types and all that. And we said that we're negotiating about only what the other side wants to receive. And maybe we need to change this to talk about received. What the other side wants to receive, and it's not exactly always the same as what you want to send. There's a lot of subtleties about that, and we were not aware of this in the past when we wrote the first version.
Okay. All right, great. Harald, do you have a comment now or after?
You know that. This parameter dot codec that you have on the screen cannot possibly match the parameters codec that you have below it, because the top one promises that it will likely send 60 FPS, and the lower one says that I cannot handle 60, I can only handle 30. We can either say that we clear the codec and just pick one, whatever it, based on whatever algorithm, or we can say that if it's possible to reduce the parameters of the codec, we act as if the user has stated that other codec instead. And that sounds very much like a bit of magic. So it's, I wouldn't say that this thing is too strict. I would say that it's not described very well. I mean, matching between codecs is mostly as specified in SDP offer answer, and it's definitely a per codec thing. It's not a across the board thing.
Okay. Yeah, I think we should still have an algorithm though, because this might be a bad example. This might be an example where they're definitely different, but the purpose of calling it the codec dictionary match algorithm was to allow for any difference. And I guess you could imagine, aren't there examples of FMTP where that are compatible?
Oh, yes. Especially for H.264, there are multiple ways to specify. Most, if you propose to send the constrained baseline, then most H.264 profiles will be able to accept that. So you should just pick some H.264 from the other side and send it. Mm. But if you send high and the other side specifies main, those are two different supersets. Supersets of baseline, so that you cannot send one on the other, and you cannot send those don't match either way. So this is extremely codec dependent.
Right, and I should clarify, as long as Bernard, maybe I should let you. Do you want to comment now? Oh, okay.
Yes. A few things. I believe you only really have a non-match where there's a situation where you need symmetry, right? That's where you have a problem. But if, in fact, you allow level asymmetry, and most codecs, by the way, do not require symmetry. So
now you're talking about the negotiation part. Where
I'm talking about the negotiation.
The stuff on the screen is about when you say that you want to send with a particular codec description, and we have to assume, using the full capabilities of that codec description, what are you allowed? What payload type are you allowed to use?
Well, maybe I'll describe my slide, and we could continue.
Yeah, I thought the original, when I was looking at the issue, and maybe I'm confused, I thought the original issue was about negotiation. And in this particular case, right, with VP9, this MaxFS and MaxFR are about receiver capability. So there's actually no incompatibility in these two strings, regardless of which one is the offer and the answer. One is sending it, saying it's capable of handling frame rate of 60, the other 30. It doesn't really matter. There's no symmetry required here. Right. The only thing that needs to happen is that when this gets negotiated is don't send more than than the peer said they can receive. There's no inherent asymmetry. And even for the cases Harold described, unless for H.264, unless you had, unless a symmetry was required, again, you know, one side can declare one thing and the other can declare another thing. And if the other one is at a higher level, the answer is don't send at that level, send it at the level that the receiver can handle. So I think overall we're failing negotiation many more. This isn't actually that complicated, aside from the symmetry required cases, which actually can fail.
Right.
Most of them should not fail.
So we need one matching algorithm for the offer answer case for negotiation.
Yeah.
And we need a different one for this particular case.
Yes. Right.
Setting with set parameters.
Correct.
Right. So I apologize if the example is not useful, but I think the Kodak dictionary match algorithm should not be confused for the negotiation algorithm, because the Kodak dictionary algorithm, it's the one that allows different codecs. If something matches, they are the same codec. So that we should not necessarily rely on that one. But I think the question here is we should specify, I think I'm hearing agreement that we should specify a selection algorithm. But this sounds like there's also a question here, an observation that it sounds like the spec does allow the user agent to clear the codec parameter after negotiation. So that just an observation here is that in that case, that means the user agent is then free to choose any negotiated codec anyway. So I could see some user agents wanting to take this codec as a hint to at least send BP9 in this case. And I mean, that seems the least surprising. So I'm just trying to standardize some of this so that this would work in all browsers and not be surprisingly not supported in some browsers, because that would lead to poor interop. And last, just a spitball idea was, instead of clearing, could we let the user agent update the codec parameter to what it decided to send based on the negotiation? And again, as long as you're using, you won't run into this problem if you use get parameters codecs, picks from those, and use it that on set parameters. So we're only talking about if you happen to use get capabilities, which includes any codec on the system, and you try to set that. And maybe that's even before negotiation, so you don't know what's going to actually end up matching. But we should perhaps infer best effort on the user agent here to try to match the application's need as closely as possible, was the thinking. Florent?
Regarding the part that you mentioned about the user agent choosing the codec to send, I'm not sure that there's a lot of specifications maintaining that, because the receiver should be able to receive any codec that it has negotiated. And on the sending side, you could run into issues where you pick a codec, it fails to initialize, you know, hardware encoder, that's an issue, and then you have to use any other one. So I'm not sure that we have any strong preference on doing any specific behavior. I believe the order in the SDP is mostly a preference, but not necessary requirements. Bernard?
Bernard, are you speaking? You're muted.
Sorry. Yeah, I agree with Florent. It's left up to the implementation to handle all the cases that Florent described.
and the sender is able to change at any time. You know, even if you had a complete failure for some reason, it was a like a hardware only codec and the hardware failed, you could switch immediately to one of the other codecs that was negotiated, as long as the receiver said they could handle it. You know, so the what actually gets sent is up to the implementation, and there are very good reasons for it, but it has to be one of the thing, you know, one of the codecs that was negotiated.
Okay, so
the recipient is able to receive.
Right.
So I'm hearing that existing spec here already allows clearing, and that there seems to be a preference for clearing the parameter. If there's any kind of discrepancy at all, it's not the same codec. Is that what we want?
We could argue that if the codec specifies, the codec singular specifies a codec description that is strictly within the parameters of one of the negotiated parameters codecs, and then it should use that one. In the case where it specifies a superset, then I think it needs clearing. But I mean, if the max FR on the first line here had been 20, it seems unreasonable not to match the one below.
So that would be
so I don't want our spec to go into how codecs match for all values of codecs, but we could make a recommendation saying that if it's a subset of the codec in the list, then it's okay to send it.
Okay. So there could be a should, maybe, in the spec. I guess we're looking for...
I would make it a non-normative note, saying that it's a good thing to pick something that matches. But the matching is too complicated to specify in this margin.
Right. So what I'm worried about... Go ahead.
Yeah, is that matching done anywhere in the case of SDP negotiation already that we could reference? Or?
There's usually some kind of description of that in each individual codec registration in the IETF specs. Usually in a section called offer answer considerations. Bernard will have seen too many of these to want to comment.
Yeah.
Okay. So it sounds like if Firefox does not have a match here, it's supposed to send VP8, or I guess it's up to it to decide whether to send VP9 or VP8 in this case. All right, Florian?
In this case, if the user is reattached to another specific codec, we can call back get set parameters. So then we can update it as needed if the behavior is differing between implementations. I think it's going to be interesting to see how people are actually using the API long term with those minor codec differences, to see what needs to be specified or what is working well enough in all implementations for users. And then we can iterate on that later. And that would probably be a good way to move forward.
Right. And there's no interest in letting the user agent update the codec parameter, right? Which it was just an idea, but I'm also happy to drop that idea.
Maybe not. If it picks something else, it might as well use it directly and clear it to say, hey, your choice has been ignored for some reason. And then using getStats, you can figure out which codec is actually in use, in which case you are going to be able to update it. I don't like when APIs are modifying parameters that you set. and setting something else, because you run into a lot of issues that we had in the past and we try to avoid.
I agree generally. The only reason I brought it up here was some concern of action at a distance, physical distance in this case, where it might work in that the remote party is going to end up, depending on which remote party you talk to, a different browser, for example, you might end up with things working if the remote party is using a different specific browser, and it would not work if they use a different browser.
It will work. The call will work. So you don't have an issue. It will pick a codec. It will do something, and which is what we expect of the API. And then the details of which codec and everything, if you really care about that, you only negotiate one. If you wanted to have more and you're fine with any of them, you can just have any of them be used.
It relies on a web application coming back and checking after negotiation that its codec parameter is still what it expected. So I'm also wondering, another option would be to disallow passing in, to only allow codecs from get parameters and not allow it ahead of negotiation. Is there a reason why we had allowed it ahead of that?
Yeah, because we want to be able to force the first codec before negotiation and before any media starts streaming. Right. Otherwise, we are missing a lot of opportunities. Mm-hmm. We'd be sending a first iframe and then changing Google codec, and then you have to send another iframe, which will lead to worse performance.
But that might be an argument then to allow the user agent to infer, treat it as a hint, right? So that, because if it's going to clear it, that's going to take time for the JavaScript to notice that and set the right codec.
Maybe. I need to think more about this.
All right. So I think we have information that we can use to implement it. Thank you.
Good.
Okay. Do we have any specific next steps that the chairs or other people need to take that we should write down? I think each item in the agenda has action items that people are clear about.
So I think that on the last one, we have and continued discussion in the issue to clarify what needs clarifying.
Yeah. Okay. Then I think we're done for the day. We'll be posting the information on TPAC. I guess the W3C will provide us with room information and other things relating to the TPAC meeting. I guess, Elad, we should talk with you offline about the joint meeting and the agenda for that. And we'll work on topics for the media working group joint meeting. And again, if people want time on the agenda, please let us know. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
See you.